Hello everybody, welcome to Mitchell Giddings Fine Arts. Thank you all for showing your support for the gallery and for our featured artist. We're so excited to present Lauren Olitski and her latest paintings. MGFA hasn't had the longevity or the pleasure of exposing our audience of thousands to such bold and explosive expression, and to feature 14 new large-scale paintings is our treat and testament to Lauren's skill and purpose. The emotion spent and emotion evoked sets Lauren's work apart, but her craft and her ability to manipulate slabs and pools of color into cohesive, coherent compositions places her firmly in the front row of vital, distinguished, successful abstract painters. We would like to thank BCTV for filming our talk tonight, and Danny Lichtenfeld, director of the Brattleboro Museum and Art Center, for his insightful text in Lauren's beautiful exhibition catalog, and for his facilitating the artist's talk tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lauren Olitski.
Hello and welcome, and thank you, Jim and Petey. Hi, Lauren. Haven't seen you in a while.
Hey,
Jim. This is a real pleasure for me, I want to take the opportunity to thank Lauren for giving me the opportunity to get to know this recent body of work and to write the essay in this catalog. It was such a treat for me to spend time at her studio and to be able to really spend a lot of time with these paintings and talk with Lauren, and it was a very rich experience for me. So thank you, and I hope this will be a similarly rich experience for you as we get to hear from Lauren about her work. So what I thought we would do today, if this suits you, is I have a couple suggestions to make as to things we talk about, and then you run with that or go in a different direction if you'd like to. And then while we're on a certain topic, I would welcome questions and comments from the audience as well.
So questions as we go along.
I think so.
I like that idea.
We'll see how that goes.
Good.
And I brought this catalog up here because when I set out to write this essay, I was so pleased to stumble back upon this quote by Giacometti that I put at the start of the essay, because it really captured something about Lauren's work, and so I just want to read that to you as we get underway. So Giacometti said, "The object of art is not to reproduce reality, but to create a reality of the same intensity." And that to me was just so apropos with regard to this incredible, intense work, and that seems to have an aspect of conjuring up like the creation of a world or a universe, a very intense one. So I want to congratulate you on all this fabulous work too, because it's pretty amazing. So what I thought we would start with is talking about materials and your studio and how you go about the work, because I think for many of us who are not artists, the experience of the work starts when it's up on the wall in a pristine setting, and there's a lot we can, you know, there's a lot to be done from that point in thinking about the work, but often we have no idea about what went into it, what the constraints were, what the parameters were. And for me, being in your studio and hearing you talk about that and seeing the materials and how you work was very powerful. So I thought maybe you could start by just kind of painting a picture for us. What does the studio look like? What does it look like when you're in there working? How do we get to the point where we have this stuff on canvas?
Well, you saw the studio. It's kind of chaos, but you know, it's just. It's a process that for me, to like, when I see the work, what's important to me when it's actually gotten to the place of being on the wall is that it looks intentional, that it holds together with really strong structure. But the truth is, getting to that point can be very chaotic. And I tend to put around me in the studio all of my toys, all the things that I want to be able to just grab in the heat of the moment, so that I don't have to think it through about, oh, I really needed some dry pigment here, and then not have it at hand. But at the same time, I can have piles and piles of things that I forget about for weeks, months, years at a time, and then at a particular moment, I'm just sort of rummaging through, and it's like, oh, this is an interesting thing, and it might take me to a place I had never intended to go. So there's, you know, you have to have that balance of willingness to make a complete ugly mess, and then rein it back in, and keep, you know, keep thinking it, thinking through the final picture, but not allowing that to stop the process. So, you know, I don't know, it's not, I mean, I finally allowed Bradley, my husband, into the studio to take some pictures of me working, because we felt like we needed a picture of me in the catalog, and I hate having my picture taken. And I thought, well, I'd rather just be doing something. And he took hundreds and hundreds of pictures, and it was really kind of eye-opening for me. We only used a handful, but to see how all over the map it looks and feels in the process. But the truth is, the mind is working all the time, and you know that it's just at a 1,000-mile-an-hour pace.
Are these your go-to materials? What are you working with here in this body of work?
Well, you know, this painting is interesting because I ran out of my go-to materials. I was thinking about this show and, you know, thinking about, I don't usually work this way, but in this particular case, I knew the constraints of this space. This is an incredibly beautiful space, but it doesn't have the highest ceilings in the world. And for some reason lately, I've been doing a lot of, everything wants to be vertical. I don't think about that when I'm creating it, but once it's done, it just, you find the direction that it works, and for whatever reason, it seemed like everything I was making wanted to be a vertical lately. But this was earlier in that process, it was early in the winter that I was making paintings and thinking about, I'm just gonna make and see what I end up with, and hopefully I'll have some large scale horizontal pictures. And I ran out of my go-to mediums. I like this really thick, gooey gel, and I ran out. And so I went to some stuff that I had around that I hadn't used in a really long time, like this this really, it's called tar gel, and that's sort of what it looks like. It's like this goo that just sort of spreads like crazy. And I had this garnet pigment, which I had bought years ago when they first put it out. I worked with this paint manufacturer called Golden Artist Acrylics, and they make different mediums, and some people go for them and they keep making them, and then if nobody's going for them, they stop making them. It turns out they don't make this one anymore, and I fell back in love with it again, because it was what I had in the studio that day, and I didn't have what I normally use. And then I found myself making something unlike anything I think I had made before this one, because it's what I had at hand. So that can be a really good thing too, to break your habit and allow yourself to make, you know, a mess and see if you can make something beautiful from that.
Sure. As I got some insight into how you work, it seemed to me that it's a really organic process and a really intuitive process. And I wondered, does it come as easily as it seems, or are there struggles? And if so, what is it like, what is it to struggle when you're creating work like this? Like, what is that? What happens, and what do you do about it?
Both things are true. This painting, I was sure it was a goddamn disaster when it was lying there wet on the floor. It just, I thought, oh, it got so muddy, and it just, you know. And then when it solidified to a certain point where I could get it up on the wall and take a look at it and turn it around, and then I could see what direction it was heading, and it had life there that I wasn't sure it had. And so, well, what's alive about it, and how do I push that further? There's a couple paintings in this room that I had pulled out that I had done years ago, and I just didn't think they worked. Mm-hmm. The one that was used, part of it was used for the cover, that one over there, I think that's it's probably about 10 years old, that painting, and mm-hmm. and it was a perfectly okay painting, but I didn't love it. And I just sort of poured paint all over it. and it got better.
Am I right in thinking that maybe one or more of these began life as a landscape?
And, no.
None of these?
No.
But sometimes you'll do that too?
No, I don't think I've ever done that actually. Oh,
really?
It's not a bad idea though. I mean, I do landscape painting, but I don't think I've ever taken a landscape and turned it into an abstract painting. Uh-huh. I did take this painting, it's a self-portrait that's been sitting in my studio for I don't know how many years. I didn't sign it or date it or anything. And I put it up on the wall because I didn't like it and I wasn't sure how to make it better. And a couple of days ago, I just ripped it off the wall and I just poured paint all over it. So maybe that'll become an abstract painting now. Wait and see what happens when it dries.
So what people may or may not realize looking at your paintings is that a lot of what they're looking at is stuff that you've poured and slathered on and moved around. But then some of them also contain actual pieces, like accretions of paint or gel that has collected somewhere else in your studio, maybe on the top of a can of paint or on a slab of plexi or something that you then scrape up and add into the painting as well. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, that one has that in it, I can see from here. And that's what I'm talking about, is sort of having things available so in the heat of the moment, it's there. So as you say, sometimes it's just like I've scraped it off I can see that circle probably was just pulled right off of the top of a dry, I often will use the top of the paint can as a palette. It's plastic, it's acrylic gels, it's plastic, so it solidifies into just a piece of plastic mm-hmm. with color in it. And it's a shape, so a shape is something you can draw with, you know. But then that also has things that I intentionally made, like if you can see, it almost looks like peeled skin or something. Mm-hmm. I have a friend who's an amazing artist, Susan Roth, and she does this a lot with acrylic, where she'll make these big spills of gel with color, and she calls them skins. And I think that's an apt name for it. And I noticed a lot of other artists have now started calling it skins, but I'm pretty sure she's the first one I ever saw that did it. And we all steal from each other. But so that's got pieces of, in that case, I will pour out on a piece of plexiglass or even sometimes just rolled sheet plastic, depending mm-hmm. on if I want it really delicate thin or if I want it thicker, and just make a variety of different goop that mm-hmm. sits there, and then when I feel like I need it, it's there. It's not necessarily with any particular work in mind, but just to have the tools around when I'm in the process to grab and make use of.
Yeah. I think you told me that the first time you did that was in a painting that you were working on, one of many of a particular tree, and that it just wasn't working out quite right, and then you sort of built up the tree by taking some.
I do it in landscape a lot because I think that it's a nice way to draw. You know, when you're drawing with wet paint, especially the way I don't use a brush, I'm not really, you know, I do in watercolor, but I mean in this kind of medium, it doesn't want to behave really. so it's hard to draw with. It's wet and goopy and it whooshes all over the place, and unless you're going to use really fine brushes and do really refined work, it's not how I work. So if I have, I also like to use cotton thread for that purpose that I just pull right off the back of the canvas. When you stretch it, you end up with all this extra thread. And you dunk it in paint and you just slather it on, and
do we see
line.
Some of that in that one? Sort of running
actually,
the middle?
Actually, that's got some cotton, that's got some canvas that was just like ripped up from the edge of a, you know, something that was lying around. Oh, there's probably some thread in there too. Yeah, I think there might be. It's almost like an archaeology project trying to figure out what's
there. Yeah,
yeah. So I do particularly like to do that with landscape, and I think that's probably when I first started doing it, was with landscape.
So using these defined pieces, using these pieces allows you to sort of draw in a defined way that the way you're using paint otherwise doesn't lend itself to. Is that fair to say?
Well, with abstract, it's not as big an issue.
Yeah, right.
You know, I mean, you're looking for a structure, but it doesn't necessarily have to look like a tree.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, talk about that. You have this idea of this circle. That's something you can draw. That's something you draw.
Well, it's an object. It becomes an object, and it. You know, and it's an object that we all relate to, right? But I don't want to, me personally at least, I don't want it to be the only thing you're seeing in there. So I want it to be a jumping off point. So like when I'm sitting right here right now, I see another little half curve, and you know, I don't really quite remember the exact process of making this painting, but I'm sure that was in my mind. I often think about relationships of objects to each other on the, you know, are they going to have a conversation or are they going to walk away from each other? You know, I want when I look at something to be drawn in and stay within the four corners. I want to be curious enough about what's going on there to keep moving through it and not just get taken off into some tangent and walk away. So often I'll have a repetitive line or curve or edge or something that may be kind of subtle, and you know, you might not even realize it's there. That's probably all the better to me, because then it's just working, and you're not really quite sure why.
A good piece of music.
I'm exactly
a good song.
It's music. It's music. Yeah. It's jam.
Thanks.
So understanding how you work and seeing how you work and what we're talking about now, I'm just blown away that you also create these small little paintings that I hadn't seen before.
Well,
it's like, is it, you know? Because the kinetic energy of doing the large ones that are sort of body scale,
right?
I get.
Right.
But these tiny ones.
Right. Well, I mean, these were sort of my little gift to the town of Brattleboro. I wanted to make sure that. Because
vertical? Horizontal?
This way, yeah. I mean, they're just as hard, actually. Honestly, sometimes they're harder. I want them to have the power of a large piece.
Yeah, right.
But I know what New England houses are like, and not too many. So I thought it would be nice to make something. Yeah. You know, small. I mean, I do small things from time to time. It's not like this is the first one.
Yeah, sure.
But I intentionally made these for this exhibition. Mm-hmm.
To me, that's so interesting to hear. And I think, you know, maybe for you, Lawrence, and for other artists here, this is what you just know about how you work. But for those of us who are not making the art, to be reminded that you're thinking about things like the height of the ceiling in the gallery, and therefore I want to work on, you know, I'm trying to make something horizontal, or people only have so much wall space, so I'm going to be making small paintings.
Yeah, well, it's kind of not like the most creative.
No, but it's reality,
and then
what you do within the parameters that you're given.
I have a choice. I started thinking about this show last summer, really, right, Petey, when you first came, and it evolved. I mean, at one point we had talked about showing the landscapes and the figures and the abstracts, and then I felt I didn't want to make it that disjointed. It's, you know, it's a very defined space here. So maybe someday we'll do it at the museum. But so I thought, well, it would be better to just show new work, work that relates to each other, you know, and I thought about this space. And so I had, you know, I had choices. I could work on particular sizes. But I did finally get a horizontal. It was hard. I repainted that painting.
I know, when I saw it, it was vertical.
Well, it still has a vertical, and honestly, I think I still like the vertical better, but I do think it works as a horizontal. I wouldn't hang it as a horizontal if I didn't think it had power that way.
Do you think that has something to do with when you're working in, when you're doing abstract, you're not in landscape mode, and it's hard for you to do abstract in horizontal?
No, I don't think that's it. I've got plenty of horizontal.
For some reason,
I can't understand exactly why. It just, because when you're working, I'm working on the floor. I have no idea what orientation it's going to be. It's not until, you know, there's like several stages to it. I mean, it's wet on wet. You're not going to stand it up. You have no idea what it's going to look like dry. It looks completely different wet. I mean, even in the photographs of that painting, it doesn't look anything like that in the pictures because all the gels are white. You have to kind of wait until those gels have dried and then they're translucent and see the color that's coming through them to even know what you've got, you know, and then you add or subtract as necessary. And, you know, it'll be a while before you get an opportunity to actually pick it up and look at it in the orientation that it's going to be as a completed work and see, well, is it holding together or isn't it? Does it got to go back to the studio floor again? A lot of my landscapes are vertical anyway, so it's not even a question of that. The only thing that's different is that with a landscape, for me at least, I am looking at a particular view of nature. But actually, the reason I call this show Painting from Nature is I was struggling to find a title for this show, and Petey was sort of pushing me towards geology because she was talking about the granite, you know, the garnet and the pumice, and I felt, well, that's true. There is this sort of earthy quality, but sometimes maybe it's also light and air and water. And so I'm really huge follower and lover of Cézanne, and when I came across his quote about painting from nature not being reproducing, about reproducing nature, I went, oh yeah, of course, everything is from nature, you know? And so, you know, the only reason I differentiate between a landscape and an abstract painting is because you can see the tree. Right. But the way I get there is pretty much the same.
I surely can't be the only one who also feels like these paintings, what the objects that you've ended up with, sort of, you know, suggest a primordial soup and landscape, you know, coming into being as well. So they're far from landscapes, they're abstract. But there's this connection with nature, and I think in the final objects too, it's in some of them feel like you're at a distant overhead view of a landscape or universe kind of emerging.
Well, this one is actually named for these two storms that were, and the name came after the painting was completed. But I was, you know, titling things is always a struggle for I think all artists, and. There happened to be these two storms that were making the news that particular day. I was trying to figure out a title for this. Australia, Queensland is Australia, right?
Yeah.
And I just happened to see a news thing on my computer screen, this photograph of these two storms that were converging over Queensland. And I thought, oh, it looks a little to be like this painting I had just done. So I gave it that title. So yeah, I think that you can see, I mean, we, you know, the truth is, it's like, why are we even interested in art or poetry or music or any of those things? We don't really know, right? They don't, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. It's not shelter, it's not food, you know, it's not reproduction, and yet it's all of those things. I mean, if it's working, that's what it, that's why, you know, it's what separates us from the animals, I suppose, is that we kind of get turned on by stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just sort of curious, because you're working on the floor, can you work on more than one piece at a time?
Yeah, I often do. I mean, I have a much bigger studio now than I used to. So yeah, I often will have two or three things going at a time, yeah. By the way, even when I'm working on landscapes, I'm on the floor.
Oh, really?
Or on a table, but flat, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
You have to walk all the way around.
You have to walk around, and I mean, it's just so that if you stand it up, it's going to slide off if it, you know, it hasn't dried yet. And of course, with landscape, you're looking at perspective, so often I will stand it up and it'll slide off. But you have to kind of squish it back together here. But yeah.
I wanted to change tracks, if it's okay with you, and ask you to tell us a little bit about your background. And. And maybe I'll try to direct certain aspects of that, but if you would just want to take that, whatever aspects of your background you think are relevant for how you get to this point where here you are, Lauren Olitski, creating this body of work today.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm blessed that I happen to have been exposed to some of the greatest art that of our time. And, you know, I don't think I'm biased in saying that. I think that you know, I have a father who covered a lot of ground, and it was pretty damn amazing ground. We didn't spend a lot of time under the same roof, but I've spent a whole lot of time under the same roof with his art, probably more than he had, because I've worked for him for most of my adult life, and he works, as most artists do, and then the work goes either into storage or out into the world, and you're on to your next thing. Well, the storage is where I work, so I've learned a lot from looking at his work. I've also learned a lot from just listening to him in terms of having courage to make mistakes in the studio and push yourself to make the best thing you can make and not stop working on something until it's as good as it can be. And not thinking, I mean, he would probably not like the idea that I said that I was thinking about, you know, what's hangable in a mm-hmm. home in New England. I mean, he never would have thought that way. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he would leave that to the art dealer and the art gallery mm-hmm. to figure out, you know, we're not the same person. But,
mm-hmm. Can you share that the moment where you sort of really dived into your abstracts?
Oh, you love that story. you know, the thing is, Danny, I think I kind of figured it out almost when you and I were talking. I mean, it wasn't that I hadn't thought about it before. I hadn't thought about it so specifically until you and I were talking last winter. So, you know, my father was trained as a portrait artist, but when he was in his late 20s, I won't tell his whole story, but anyway, he went through a lot of self-discovery before he became an abstract painter, and then he made his name and his career as an abstract painter. But he'd always done figurative mostly, although some landscape, but mostly figurative work. And around the mid-90s, he started doing landscapes. And he had always actually really been very supportive of my landscape painting. He thought that my landscapes were fairly original. And he was kind of a champion of those. my landscapes were very, all, like my painting, these paintings are, tend to be quite large and very muscular, a lot of texture, a lot of layering. In any case, I was a little bit hesitant to do abstract work because of his having covered all this territory already. And I, you know, as a young person, I think I was a little bit naive also thinking that I was going to get a lot of attention being his daughter, was not the case. So I was afraid to put something out that I didn't feel was going to stand up to whatever scrutiny it was going to get. So I kind of kept my work to myself. But once I felt secure with the landscape and the nudes, I did a lot of figurative work. I did try to, you know, get a career started, and as I said, you know, it wasn't like everybody was saying, oh, look what Jules Olitski's daughter was doing, because the truth is not that many people were saying, look what Jules Olitski was doing at that point. His own career had taken, he was, you know, working in isolation a lot. He had a big name for himself in the 60s and 70s and not so much in the 80s. And so for whatever reason, he started making a lot of landscapes, mostly small works on paper, beautiful, very Turner-esque. All his classical training came back, and he was really, really enjoying it, and making monoprints and making watercolors and pastels and a few canvases as well. And he stopped doing abstract painting for a number of years. And as I said, Bradley and I work for my dad, and in the fall every year, all his work from the summer would show up in Vermont, and we would stretch and photograph and catalog that work. And I was really missing his abstract paintings. I loved his landscapes, but I was missing the abstracts. And I just thought, screw it, he's not going to do it, I'm going to do it. And it really was, it took that for me. I had to just say, you know, like, I'm just going to do it. And once I did do it, it felt kind of natural. It just was like, why did I wait so long? You know, this was really an exciting, fun thing that I felt like I had the vocabulary for. Why, I guess, wouldn't I have? But it didn't, I didn't realize I did.
Is it a struggle or a conscious thing for you, or was it maybe when you first started doing abstracts after that juncture? Is this too much like his work? Are you thinking too much about his work? Was that,
I don't
was
think
that ever
about
a thing?
It in the studio, you can't. And that was also something I learned from him. He's like, you can't think in the studio, period, about what people are going to think, because you're just going to make mud. You're just not going to make vital work if you're worrying about what people are going to think about it. But yeah, I mean, I hear, and I mean, even myself, it's like, you know, I look at things and I know I use the material very differently than he did, the handling of it, the way I use it is different. But at the same time, I'm using acrylic paint on canvas within a rectangular space. Which is these days actually a little old-fashioned. I don't think he would ever use glitter. But I use a lot more metallics and shiny things than he did for the most part. Not that he never did, but I don't think they look like my dad's work. However, I think that if you weren't as studied of his work or my work as I am, you might not necessarily be able to differentiate right off the bat. I think you have to be familiar with the art to see this is, doesn't look like, it looks like my work, but it is a subtle difference probably. But I can't, the truth is, Danny, it's like I'm 58 years old. When I was 35, it bothered me a lot. And at this stage of my life, it's like, we just have to do what we're gonna do.
Sure.
And I have to embrace the fact that I have a father who is incredible, at what he did. And he covered so much territory that I really think anyone who's working as an abstract artist today has got to come against what he already did. And you have to like learn from it and then fight it and then do what you're gonna do. And hopefully, you know, come out ahead of the game.
So to that point, when I was looking at this painting in the studio, which has that circular piece up there, sort of around the corner in the studio are some of your father's late paintings with orbs in them.
In the warehouse.
Right, not in the studio. And I think I said something about how, you know, I sort of drew a connection, and you said something to me like, what, did he patent the orb?
That's right, right. He owns that circle.
So, but, you know, I think that, you know, if you really know Jules Olitski's work, and yeah, he did cover so much ground, so there's you can find virtually anything probably in somewhere in his work at some point or another. But there are certain things that crop up, I think, here and there in your work in a way that I personally just consider to be organic and successful within the pieces that you're creating, and they don't strike me, and I, based on what you've told me, they're clearly not deliberate homages or references to his work, and it seems like, of course, it's perfectly organic and natural. Why? You spent so much time around that work. Why would certain elements of it not, you know, peek out here and there?
Celebrate the lineage.
It seems I'm impressed with where you seem to be in such a very comfortable space with regard to his, you know, operating in a realm that, as you say, you're moving around acrylic paint within a rectangular frame, doing non-representational work. I'm really impressed with how you seem to just be in a place that's, it's coming from you, and part of what that means coming from you is that there may be bits of him in there as well.
I think for anybody that's making anything, you want it to hold up, you know, you want to create something that maybe is adding to the vocabulary, that is interesting, that is stimulating in some way, and that should be the goal. And it should, and you know, I mean, I can find Cezanne in my work as well. You know, I mean, I think that, or I hope to, I should say, I strive to find Cezanne in my work as well. I mean, that, you know, we find our champions, mm-hmm. and then we ask ourselves, well, what is it about that that's turning us on? You know, if you are in a museum or an art gallery or someone's studio, the biggest compliment to that artist is it makes you want to go do something yourself. It makes you want to create something. It wakes up something in your brain that says, oh, I'm alive. How do I let the rest of the world know I'm alive, right? So, you know, that's the only thing you really ought to think about. And I just was really, really lucky that I got to spend my whole adult life around some of the greatest art of our time, you know. Just
the way it went. Yeah. Lauren, could you discuss the relationship between the physicality of the paint and the image?
An image?
An image, yeah.
Well, I mean, hopefully there's no recognizable imagery in these works.
Or the relationship to it being a rectangle. That's what I mean. As an image.
I'm sorry.
Just as a rectangle. The relationship between the physicality of the paint and the rectangle.
You know,
specifically,
I've been thinking about the rectangle a bunch lately. I was in France recently, and a friend's studio was taking paper from a paper factory, like the leftover, I don't know what there's probably a name for it, but it's like a paper sludge in a way. It's like a big pile of paper that's when it, it's wet and it gets all kinds of weird shapes to it, and then it hardens like sculpture in a way. And he's been painting with it, and it was, it's really probably for me, I thought it was like the best work I'd seen this particular guy do. And another friend of mine who I mentioned earlier, Susan Roth, she tends to make shaped canvases. And I think that I admire artists that are able to see that organic shape within the two-dimensional, you know, work that they're presenting, a painting, right? And I've been thinking about it. Is it something, I don't want to do something that's just contrived. And so far, I have felt that within the boundary of those four sides, I've been content. You know, I feel like I can get where I want to go with that constraint. I've also started making sculpture recently, so I feel like maybe that experience of making sculpture might allow me to sort of imagine what it would be like if I didn't have the constraint of a rectangle. Honestly, both of these two artists that I just mentioned have the luxury, and it is a luxury, to be full-time artists. And I think that for me, I've spent so much of my time being a full-time something else, that when I get in the studio, I want it to just be available to me to work, because I may only have a limited amount of time. And so having structures that I've already paid for, you know, that are sitting there, is like, okay, now I can make something with what I have. And I've spent most of my life making stuff with what I already have. But the freedom to make something and then figure out how it's going to get put together to get on a wall, I've never allowed myself that before. I think it's maybe that it's certainly something I'd be curious to let myself try. So I'm not making a value judgment, is what I'm saying. I think for me, the reason I haven't done it is just because I haven't had the wherewithal to do it. But there's no reason why it should be within four sides, right? It really should be, is it holding together? Is it vibrant? Does it work? Does it work?
Yeah. All right. This is maybe a little unfair, but particularly for people sitting on that side of the room, but this little painting over here beyond Danny has a little piece of drawing in it that brings up a question for me. And in the upper left of it, the way that you've let the paint run, actually, roughly, in Lauren Olitski world, it looks like right angles and straight lines. And it might be the only place in the show where right angles and straight lines are.
That's interesting.
And that little bit of drawing contrasts with the whatever else is going on in that painting in a really interesting way. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if that was an observation that I'm applying to the painting, first off, which is entirely possible, or whether it's something you thought about as a way of contrasting, you know, all the phenomenology of the paint and what looks like little chambers, little right angles, little rectangles, which is other than all that phenomenology of the paint. So, I mean, if you wanted to, we could talk about that painting in the way that those two things are working with each other.
It is a technique that I do make use of from time to time. I do it in landscape and figurative as well, and I think of it as a structural kind of grid, but I'm not hand painting it in. I'm doing it
by letting the paint run, tipping the canvas.
Yeah. And I have a feeling that
there's, you can see,
isn't this painting as well,
and also
I'm sure, yeah, it's in that one too. It's just not as overt, but
Well, I like that technique, and I like the way it kind of highlights the other things that you do.
Well, so I do like to, sometimes I feel like a painting needs that contrast between just all over, like, wild, orgasmic medium, bathing in the paint, feeling of, you know, and like, oh, what is holding it together? What is, you know, and so it is a device in a sense. And I try to have it just kind of be there without it being like, oh, look what I'm doing. With everything I'm doing, that's sort of how I feel. It's like I want something to work without it being, oh, look what she's doing necessarily. Or look what this particular device is doing to make this work. But it is something that I like. I like hard and soft, or I like, you know, structured and chaotic. And I like to see where they kind of come together and talk to each other and bang up against each other. So that's one of the different things that I kind of play with when I'm making something. That's for me what makes something exciting is when it's when you sort of almost push it to the place of mud and mess and it's not making any sense and you should throw it out. And then it's like, yeah, but for some reason I like it anyway. So why is that? And for me, the reason usually has to do with a structure. So what is it that's giving it that structure? And in that particular case, it's that.
Yeah, I think so too.
There was a question over here. Yeah, Pete?
I'm just wondering if you're starting your process, your painting process, in more of a meditative, quiet, introspective space, or a very kinetic, energetic, you have your jockey shoes and shorts on kind of space.
Sort of start out like making a really, really big mess. You know, just pouring something right. I gotta get started. It's like, there's nothing more intimidating than a blank canvas, right? And all the pressure of making that alive. How do you make canvas and paint and plastic alive, you know? So, usually the best thing for me is to just get it out of the way and make a big mess. Just pour something down. And then I have something I have to deal with. Once I've done that, then it's like, oh, what that says, oh, that's interesting right there, or I can't stand that, I've got to scrape that away, right? Whatever it is, but it starts a conversation with me in that thing that then gets built on.
Are there other questions? Yeah, Kathy.
Maybe, Lauren, you can talk a little bit more about Cezanne.
About what?
About Cezanne. What it is in his work that you think you respond to.
You know, the paintings of Cezanne that I love the most are the ones where the objects are right there in your face. You know, where he's painting the mountain as if his nose was right up against the rock, right? There's this darkness to it and intensity and desperation feel, you know. And to me, I mean, if you took away the fact that it's a mountain or a rock or a tree, it's a color field painting in a sense. You know, it's an abstract painting. And he wasn't making pretty pictures. You know, he was making he was capturing an intense mood that goes beyond the actual landscape itself. I mean, Ariel and I were recently in Aix-en-Provence, and we went to his last studio, which he only used a couple of years, and then they tell you where you can go to find this, one of the views that he painted, and we went up there, and it's incredibly beautiful and moving, and they have this sort of corny atrium thing set up with reproductions of a bunch of paintings that were done from that view that are in different, you know, museums and so on. And they're terrible reproductions. They're sitting out in the sun and they're just being, you know, it's like the colors awful. The whole thing's awful. But it's kind of okay, because it's like, well, you know, there are a few of the paintings you've probably seen and you feel familiar, and it's like, you know, and there's a sort of touristy aspect to it. But at the same time, it's incredible. You can't get past the power of being in a space where these works were envisioned. And yet, when you look at it, this vista that he was looking at, it doesn't really look like any of his paint. I mean, you know, he was finding his art in that view, as opposed to the view finding itself in his art. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I don't know. I mean, why do any of us have our top people that we're drawn to?
I wasn't looking for. I just am really curious, because he was kind of an artist of economy of means.
Right.
You know,
right.
Very economical paintings.
Right.
They're very, if you might say, even reserved, right, in his dialogue with those spaces. And
but his paintings and also very often look like they shouldn't work. Like there's
okay.
just this kind of like, right on the verge of disaster happening. They just seem, there's this power of managing an image that's spiraling out of control, you know. And he's only, his palette is, you know, he didn't have access to glitter. it's a, you know, it's a limited palette. And yet it's got so many levels and dimensions to it.
Lauren. I want to ask about a different point. You were a minute ago talking about making a big mess and then the decision-making starts. But a little bit later into the painting, there's another transition point where the painting starts to work for you, and I assume the painting takes over from you a little bit and tells you what to do. And then there's another different kind of decision-making process. Can you talk about your feelings at that moment in a painting?
Most of these take place over a period of days or weeks or whatever, because you have, you know, I tend to start wet on wet, and so you have to allow that to just kind of solidify a little bit, and then go back into it. Otherwise, you do end up with mud. You know, but
what about later in the process, when the painting starts speaking to you?
I mean, I think the painting starts speaking to you right away if you're lucky. If it doesn't, then I usually just take a bucket of something and pour it over it and walk away. And then sometimes that ends up being like great, you know, because you've walked away and then the paint sort of, I mean, I sometimes intentionally will do that with a very thin wash, because then the surface of whatever you've already put there will start to peek through in ways, and the color will puddle in different ways, and then you come back and you can say, oh, okay, there is a structure here that I wasn't seeing or I wasn't connecting to, and where, you know, what now, what is it saying to me? Right? Yesterday it was telling me to go take a hike because you're useless and you don't know how to do anything and you should just like bury your head in the sand. And today it's like, oh, God came in over last night and added some fairy dust, and now there's something to work with, you know, thank you. You know, it's constantly a dialogue with what's there and what's here.
Are there certain things that are often like last things or like final touches that you deal with toward the end of the process?
The thing about acrylic is it's not very forgiving. Everything that you do shows. And you can't, you know, like what I love, you know, that sort of fun, gooey beginning part, you can't, if I was decided next week that this painting is no good, and I want to rework it. I can never go back to that first place where it was all soft and fluid and fun, right? I'd have to, even if I, and probably what I would do is I would take something and pour over the whole thing. Every single little crust and layer is going to show through. And then you figure out, well, where are the pieces that are working. Maybe you cut the painting up, and you collage it onto something else. You know, you just don't know. But I think that in answer to your question, no. There's no particular last thing or first thing. Maybe there is a first thing, because the first thing I pretty much always do is put a brown down a color, a wet stain of some sort, just to get away from that damp, brightening white canvas, you know, you have to do something. But it's not like there's any particular last moment. I mean, that painting right there, you saw it, you know, and I thought it was done. I'd had it professionally photographed. It doesn't look like that painting anymore. And that, there was a lot of just pouring paint on top of it, and then I went back in with the metallics, and then I went back in with some textures, you know, some dry paint and things, and I don't know what the last thing was on that particular picture, but there was turning and pouring and hoping I didn't ruin it, and whatever, and then hopefully a little bit of magic gets in there somewhere.
Kim.
Lauren, hi. We were talking much earlier about the verticality that you're so
about
focused,
the
verticality of the pictures that you're so focused on at the moment. And as I'm looking at them and sitting among them, and I've sort of spoken to Petey about this, they're almost like portals to me. You know, you can almost really bodily walk in and into them and through them. And I wonder, and even though that horizontal one is actually one of my favorites, I don't feel like I can walk into it. So I wonder if that's subconsciously, possibly, maybe, I mean, is that,
I don't
probably
know.
Didn't apply, I'm applying that to, but it's really a really interesting bodily reaction.
Yeah, I don't know, that may be why, yeah. I don't know. I know that when something is finished, I take it and I turn it and I turn it and I turn it until I feel like, okay, now it's working.
Yeah.
For, you know, like, if you turn it the wrong way, it feels wrong. It feels like it's not holding together for some reason. Either your eye's going off into space, or that side is completely separating itself from that side. You know, it won't work. And it may not work any direction, and then it goes back on the floor and you work on it some more. But if it, usually there's a way that goes, oh, now it makes sense. And for some reason in the last year or so, most of them have wanted to make sense vertically. The rare one is that little one right there. Actually, it's the only painting I've ever done where I feel like it works every single way I turned it. It was like, oh, let's go anyway. And we needed a horizontal, so we gave it one of the horizontals, and Petey and Jim chose which one. It's got both of them. It just worked. I don't know why. That one just is like a little, it's like a little gem. It just kind of is comfortable whichever way it wants to go. That one, I'm very happy with it this way. I actually, personally, the vertical is my, I still prefer the vertical on that one, but it, I mean, I tried like heck to make that a horizontal, and there was just no way. It just didn't, it was fine, but it didn't make me go, ah, I want to go, ah. I want to go, I like that. You know, if I can't do that, then nobody else is going to.
It just has an interesting effect.
Yeah.
The primordial soup.
Yeah.
I think we should wrap up soon. Are there one or two more questions, maybe? A
whole bunch more questions.
Kathy?
I was wondering about the sparkliness.
Well, all right, so how long ago was this? Maybe 10 or so years ago. I stumbled into this little paint store in Manhattan. God, it might be even longer ago than that. But anyway, it was a long time ago. It's on
9th Street, I think, around Avenue B. And I had heard about this guy who was making his own pigments and paints and stuff. This very funny little guy, Art Guerra. And he had jars of shiny stuff, right? So I liked the look, you know, I thought, well, this could be fun. So I bought, I don't know, a dozen or so different kinds of it and played with it and really, really had fun. Now, I'd already been using a lot of gold and pearlescent, and this, you know, like iridescent white silvers and interference paints, which are these like metallic, they're not metallic exactly, but they're a mica pigment that when the light hits it a certain way, the color shifts. So often they just sort of look very milky, but if you look at it from a particular angle, you'll see a violet or you'll see, you know, blue or something depending on which one you're using. And I'm very attracted to light in painting and trying to get light in paint, in a painting. And metallics lend themselves to that, you know. So anyway, I used a bunch of these metallic pigments. And I don't want them to, I want them to enhance the work. I don't want them to stand on top of the work. So I often will use them with a color that's very similar to it nearby, you know, so it sort of feels like it's coming out. My hope is that it feels like it's naturally coming out of what is there. So I used quite a lot of them, and then I had a show in Florida, and this collector asked me about whether they would hold up, you know, and I said, yeah, of course, you know, everything I get is from a reputable company. And then Art Guerra himself, I ran into him a couple days later in Florida, apparently he's got summer, winter's down there, and I said to him what this collector had said, he goes, I have no idea. Like, oh my God, you know? So, this is not really an answer to your question, but anyway, it's a tangent, but Mark Golden, who runs Golden Artist Acrylics, is such a sweet guy, and I said to him, I didn't buy this from you. And he has this incredible factory, and they test everything, and he took all of my colors, and he put them through their paces in their factory, and he tested them, and he said they're all light safe, they're not going to fade on you, they're fine. But then it's like, you know, this is this small backbiting world that artists live in. So an artist friend of mine started using them like crazy, right? Everything he was doing had these pigments in after he'd been at my show. And so I stopped using them. You know, because it's like, certain artists get identified with a picture, and it's like it's hard to get away from that. And so I just thought, well, let them have it. And then when I did this particular painting, and I had run out of all of my usual materials, and what did I have? I had these pigments, I had this garnet gel, I had this tar gel, and I had a lot of fun with it. And I went, you know, I don't use them in the same way that he uses them, so what the hell? It's the same with, you know, how do you get away from, you know, Jules Olitski or Susan Roth, who I think is one of the great, you know, she's completely unknown, although she has an amazing show right now at the Eberson Museum. But I know her, and I love her work, and I'm really influenced by her, and she uses these skins, and now, you know, and I use them. So it's, I think that we have to get the ego out of the way, and we have to say in the studio, okay, where did I learn about this? It's one thing to learn something from Cézanne. It's another thing to learn it from a contemporary. And can we do it in a way that it becomes our work and not their work? And, you know, I think we can.
Yeah.
I have a question, and then I just had a little thing I wanted to say. The question is, when I was at the studio where you're talking about your body of work, are you usually starting with a variety of different colored grounds? In other words, coloring your canvas. Yeah, you're staining it.
Sort of staining.
Yeah, to kickstart your thinking, or just does it matter?
You know, I used to. Well, I shouldn't even say that. I was about to say I've been using a lot of lighter grounds to start with now, but now I'm looking that's not true. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think it's whatever I feel like doing that day. You know, I just, today I'm going to, this color, you know, I don't know. I have no idea. Honestly, I can't answer that. It's just...
Yeah, and then I just wanted to say there's a wonderful memory I have of when your dad came to a Wyndham Art Gallery in the early 90s, and he was... He was so supportive of you. I remember that as just a really wonderful moment. What?
Yes, I got attacked. Do you remember that?
I do. It was really... But he came, and he was... and you had some really interesting figurative pieces in that show.
What's that?
You had some interesting figurative pieces in that show.
Yeah, it was the nude show.
Yeah.
So, anyway. Yeah. No, I know. He was really... that meant a lot to me. Yeah. I mean, our relationship was, he was an artist, you know. He wasn't the best dad necessarily, but and we hadn't spent a lot of time, he certainly didn't spend a lot of time talking to me about my work. So that wasn't a really nice moment,
I think we should allow time, now that you have a lot more to bring to bear and you're looking and thinking about these paintings, for you, on everyone on your own, to spend time with the paintings, and you'll hang around, right?
Sure,
and if people have more questions, is that, that seem okay?
Yeah.
All right, well, thank you all so much. I'm more than-
space for, you know, somebody like me to show what I'm doing. You know, any artist really needs an opportunity to have somebody look at the work. Otherwise, what's the point? It's about communication. And it's courageous for you to show work like this in Vermont, I think in Southern Vermont. And I appreciate the opportunity. And Danny was like such a sweetheart to say yes. And then to actually engage with the work in a way that I had no idea whether you were going to respond to it or not. And it means a lot to me. So thank you. Thank all for your time.